If you read EKGs, there's a really good chance you went through Dubin's. I mean, it's kind of like a rite of passage. You've got to put your time into Dubin's, right? And if you physical exam, if you know physical exams, you probably did Bates' physical exam book. Now, if you are involved with business, you've probably put time into Jim Collins' work, Good to Great and Great by Choice. And Great by Choice talks about businesses that thrive in uncertainty. And it's a pretty powerful book. I highly recommend it if you're an entrepreneur. But they talk about risk. And in the process of this book, they talk about businesses that thrive in uncertain times have mitigated risks in three categories. And the three categories are deathline risk, asymmetrical risk, and uncontrollable risk. Now, to the leadership of the American Academy of Physician Assistants, and to those that are driving this optimal team practice model, my hope is that you put time into this OTP risk assessment. And there's three different risks: deathline risks, asymmetrical risk, and uncontrollable risks. And I had a couple lengthy conversations with people within the AAPA about optimal team practice. And I'm open for a dialogue, guys. This cannot be a talk about ego. It can't be. You can't go there. That's not good for our profession. First and foremost, the only reason I'm doing this video is what's better for patient care? What's better for patient care? How do we best serve our practice? How do we best serve our patients with the practice of medicine? And any other conversation than that, I'm going to be kind of deaf to. That's just, I'm telling you. If you're saying, well, we got to protect our piece of the pie, we got to protect our part of the healthcare dollar, I really don't have that conversation with you, then go for it. Have your own, just exclude me from the conversation. Well, the nurse practitioner is getting all of our jobs. Okay, I want to know what's better for healthcare. I want to know what's better for the patients that we care for. And if you say that optimal team practice is better for excellent patient care and patient delivery, then I want to have that conversation. Too many people are so concerned about protecting their piece of the pie that I don't think it's healthy and I don't think it's right. It's not my true motivation. So you do not have to listen to me if you're governed just by being a consumer and not a baker. Now remember, there's consumers and bakers. Consumers consume. So if someone puts a pie in front of you and you consume part of the pie, that means other people aren't getting the pie. There's also bakers. Bakers are people who just cook. They just cook. They cook. Now I know it's the responsibility of our leadership to preserve our profession, and I respect that. And I'm not saying that I'm adamantly opposed to optimal team practice. It could be a good thing. I don't know for sure, but the bottom line is neither do you. You don't know for sure. You can't know for sure. But we have to talk about three different risks. So we have deathline risk, asymmetrical risk, and uncontrollable risk. So what's deathline risk? Deathline risk is if it happens, our profession's done. We die. Now, what are the deathline risks within our profession? Are there any? Now, what if the AMA adamantly opposes what we're doing, or the medical community adamantly opposes, saying we not only oppose it, but we're going to fight against it? Could that be a deathline risk? If the AMA came right out and said what the PAs are doing is dangerous for healthcare, we don't support it. Now, I understand after talking at length to a very strong proponent of OTP yesterday, they said, well, we've never been supported by the American Medical Association or governing bodies of physicians. Okay, and I don't know that. I'm not a political guy. And this, you can criticize me on that. But I'm saying that if the medical community doesn't support us, or what if they overtly go out and say, don't use PAs because they're going to harm us, go, what if they, because of this, openly support nurse practitioner, the nurse practitioner model? Is that a possibility? Is it a realistic possibility? And once again, guys, I'm not looking for an ego battle here. I want to have a conversation. What's the deathline risk? And remember, I look at the global model of the spread of the PA profession. What we do in the United States is going to spread to other parts of the world. And I have a lot of senior PAs saying, hey, we do really well practicing independently now. And I want to say, well, we didn't get there by practicing independently. We got there as dependent practitioners. There have always been a physician there that we would talk to. Okay, so first part is deathline risk. And I'd ask anybody watching this video, what else would be a deathline risk that could absolutely cripple our profession? Well, what if the governing bodies who reimburse somehow change our reimbursement structure? If all of a sudden we can't get paid for our services, or we get paid a whole lot less than nurse practitioners, that would potentially crush our profession. I think those are very realistic things to consider at the very least. Once again, anybody who's watching this, I want to know, what do you think is the death line risk of the potential change of optimal team practice and implementing it? And it sounds like it's already going there anyways. Second risk is asymmetrical risk. What are the asymmetrical risks? Like, you know, if it's a 50-50 risk, and if you put up $1 and you get $2, well, that's an even risk. What are the things that really are asymmetrical in the risk profile? Now, as a physician assistant educator, I work a lot with students, board of view, and going into schools, and normally teaching PAs in the first 5 years of their clinical practice. That's really my target market, who I most identify with. They're the people that I sit down with coffee with and sit in class with. This optimal team practice is now doing a concern, something I have a big concern about. How do we train the new PAs? And if a physician's not directly responsible, well, it comes down to one of two things, and this is what I was told yesterday by this person. I'm not going to name their names, but they're kind of important in the PA world. They said, well, one of two things are going to happen. Either they're going to be chaperoned and mentored by a senior PA, or they're going to be more residency programs. Now, is there any problem with that at all? Now, I have a couple problems with that. Number one is, PA programs are popping up all across the United States, and there's a real deficiency with educators. There's not enough educators for the programs that are popping up. Okay, that's a concern that's echoed with program directors. Not enough well-trained physician educators. Are there enough PAs in a position that could really train the new providers? Okay, that's just a question. I'm not saying there is or isn't. And again, I don't want an ego battle here. I just want a conversation. Any of the comments on this video that are ego-based and selfish and just kind of being cantankerous, I'm just going to delete and not respond, but I'm very open to a dialogue. Is there enough well-trained physician assistants to mentor the young ones? And the second question is, you know, residency programs. If you want specialized training, more residency programs will pop up. And it's like, that's just going to take longer to train. That was the idea of the PA model, was that we could train people quickly so they could help patients. So yeah, I guess we could have more residency programs, and I'm sure there will be. How does the ARCPA feel about this? The accreditation body of physician assistants who dictate the education for PA students. Is there going to be different education requirements if PAs don't need or aren't falling under the auspices of a doc that's watching out for us? And the NCCPA, they came out with a new template for what we need to study in the boards. Is that going to change at all? I'm very concerned about the education of our new graduates. I'm very concerned. I preach that when a physician gets out of med school, they still don't know anything. That's why they have a residency program. That's why they are very closely chaperoned. And as a new graduate PA, you still don't know anything until you get a few thousand patients under your belt. And you're very closely chaperoned and supervised. Like, you can't read an EKG and you can't learn it from a textbook. You have to deal with hundreds of EKGs and sick patients and get mentored, because if you misread an EKG, the patient dies. And I'm really concerned that a lot of the decision makers for this OTP are senior PAs who've been doing it for a while. And I'm hoping you're not forgetting about the new graduate PAs and how they're going to be mentored. I acknowledge that people say, well, it's going to be done more at the practice level, and that very well could be fine. That could be fine. But I'm concerned about that. And the last one is uncontrollable risk. What are things we really can't control? You know, we really can't control what the nurse practitioners are doing. They're colleagues. We're still trying to care for patients. They're caring for patients. We're caring for patients. We really can't control what they're doing. We can't control what they're doing. We really can't control what the AMA is doing, but we could bring them into the dialogue and say, what do you guys want? And I'm sure as leadership, you guys are doing that. So I just want to be a voice of, let's not charge forward as aggressively without having some of these answers answered. And again, it sounds like the bull's out of the barn and we're doing it, but I'm just cautious, guys. That's all. I love our profession. Great profession that's gone global. Okay. I'm concerned about it. I'm concerned about some of these decisions, and it's out of love for our profession. So I'm open for any dialogue. I'd welcome the dialogue, professional dialogue without ego. And first and foremost, the deal is, do you agree that the number one concern has got to be optimal care to the patients? And that means access to care, okay? clearly, you don't need a plastic surgeon for every single laceration. Clearly, I'm very competent at doing lacerations. So you don't need a plastic surgeon for everything. We need PAs to be competent within the capacity of what they're being asked to do. Good luck. God bless.